What the Study Says.
Welcome back to What the Study Says. I'm Dr. Kai.
And I'm Dr. May. Today, we are wrestling with one of the greatest biological paradoxes of the human body. How does your defense system, this incredibly powerful army designed to wipe out anything foreign, know when to stop? How does it protect you from threats without simultaneously launching a devastating internal civil war?
It's like the ultimate counterterrorism unit, really. It eliminates thousands of foreign invaders every single day. But the moment it misidentifies your own cells, say the insulin-producing cells in your pancreas or the lining of your gut as the enemy, the result is serious, often fatal autoimmune disease.
So the fundamental question isn't just how the immune system fights, but what enforces its self-control. And thanks to a decades-long effort that fundamentally reshaped immunology, we have the definitive answer recognized now by the Nobel Assembly.
Yes, we are celebrating the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine 2025, awarded jointly to Mary E. Brunkow, Fred Ramsdell, and Shimon Sakaguchi.
A huge achievement.
Absolutely. They're honored for their, quote, discoveries concerning peripheral immune tolerance, basically, identifying the immune system's high security patrol and, crucially, its molecular master switch.
Our mission today, then, is to unpack this chronological scientific detective story. We want to show you exactly how the discovery of these cells, regulatory T cells, and the gene that controls them, FOXP3, launched a revolution.
Right, a revolution treating everything from autoimmune disorders to cancer.
You are about to get the deep dive on the security guards of your own body.
Okay, let's start at the beginning of this timeline. We need to go back to 1995 with Shimon Sakaguchi. The immunological world at that time was pretty comfortable with the status quo, you could say.
Yes, the conventional wisdom was that the bulk of self-tolerance, that is, the immune system's ability to recognize and tolerate self-tissue, was established early on in the thymus.
Central tolerance, they called it.
Exactly. It was like the final inspection at the factory gates. Any T cell showing even a hint of self-reactivity was supposed to be eliminated before it even entered circulation. Pretty neat idea.
A bit too neat, perhaps. Sakaguchi realized that, well, the system couldn't be perfect. T cells with self-reactive potential are bound to escape that quality control sometimes, right? Or maybe develop that reactivity later on.
Okay.
So he swam against the tide and proved that the immune system had a more sophisticated secondary policing mechanism out in the tissues, what we now call a peripheral tolerance system.
Ah, so not just central control, but guards on patrol too.
Precisely. And this is where his breakthrough lands. He identified a previously unknown class of immune cells, these specialized security guards patrolling the body. He called them regulatory T cells, or TR cells for short.
TR cells, okay.
What's fascinating here is that he didn't just find a new cell type, he demonstrated its crucial function. These TR cells actively seek out and suppress those self-reactive lymphocytes that manage to escape the thymus.
So they're the brakes on the immune system's horsepower.
That's a great way to put it. And the relevance for you, the listener, is immediate. Sakaguchi showed that if you diminish the numbers or activity of these regulatory T cells, the consequences are severe.
What kind of consequences?
You get the spontaneous development of horrific, organ-specific autoimmune diseases. We're talking thyroiditis, type 1 diabetes, severe gastritis, things like that.
Wow.
It proved that these security guards are not optional. They are absolutely essential for self-survival.
Okay, so Sakaguchi finds the cells and shows their vital job. That brings us to the next massive piece of the puzzle, right?
Right. We have the function, suppression, and the cell type, PR cell, but what controls it? What's the molecular instruction manual? The genetic basis?
That answer came a few years later in 2001 from the labs of Mary Brunkow and Fred Ramsdell. And interestingly, they weren't even initially studying tolerance, were they?
No, not directly. They were studying a really devastating genetic disorder in mice called the Scurfy mutant.
The Scurfy mouse? That name, Scurfy, sounds almost quaint, doesn't it?
It does. But the disease it describes is anything but quaint. This was a fatal, X-linked, recessive lymphoproliferative disorder.
Okay, break that down. Lymphoproliferative.
It means the lymphocytes, the T cells specifically, were multiplying uncontrollably. The phenotype was characterized by this massive activation and expansion of T cells, specifically CD4 plus T lymphocytes, which then infiltrate and destroy multiple organs.
So the mouse's own immune system was just running rampant.
Completely rogue. The mice were doomed. Hemizygous males were typically dead just 16 to 25 days after birth. It was incredibly aggressive.
It's 16 days. It's barely any time at all.
No. So Brunkow and Ramsdell began the arduous task of hunting for the single defective gene responsible for all this chaos, and they found it.
And that gene was?
They named the gene FOXP3. The protein it codes for, they called Scurfin.
FOXP3. Okay, so what exactly was wrong with FOXP3 in these poor scurfy mice?
It was actually a tiny error in the mouse, just a two-base pair insertion in exon 8. Really small change.
Two letters added to the code.
Exactly. But that tiny insertion caused a devastating frame shift in the genetic code. It basically garbled all the instructions downstream, resulting in a completely truncated, useless Scurfin protein product.
So the protein was cut short.
Right. That tiny change meant the Scurfin protein lacked its crucial C-terminal forkhead domain. That domain is vital for binding to DNA and acting as a transcription factor controlling other genes.
So without that part, it couldn't do its job.
Precisely. Without that functional domain, the gene couldn't control what it was supposed to control. The whole system just collapsed into autoimmunity.
Okay, mouse genetics. But here's where it gets really interesting for human health, right?
Yeah.
Connecting this tiny mouse with, well, massive implications.
Absolutely. They quickly showed that mutations in the human equivalent of this gene, the human ortholog, is called FOXP3, caused a severe human syndrome.
And that is?
IPEX. It stands for immune dysregulation, polyendocrinopathy, enteropathy, X-linked syndrome.
IPEX. Sounds serious.
It is. Like the scurfy mice, IPEX is a severe, usually fatal disorder in human nails because it's X-linked. It results in that terrible triad of symptoms, immune dysregulation, failure of endocrine glands like the pancreas or thyroid, and severe gut disease, the enteropathy.
So the parallels were striking.
Incredibly striking. The fact that the scurfy mouse, with its uncontrolled T-cell activation, shared these phenotypic features, and crucially, a common genetic defect, FOXP3, FOXP3, with IPEX, well, it suddenly made the mouse model invaluable.
Right. It gave researchers an immediate platform to study a rare, fatal human disease. You could actually model it.
Exactly. And they found specific human mutations, too. For instance, sometimes just changing a single molecular building block, like a G changing to an A leading to an amino acid change, ALA384R, or deleting just two letters, CT, causing another frame shift.
Tiny errors, devastating consequences.
It showed that the integrity of this one single gene, FOXD3, was literally a matter of life or death.
Okay, that sets the stage perfectly for the synthesis, doesn't it? The grand unifying theory that, well, that earned all three scientists the Nobel Prize. We had Sakaguchi's functional cells, the TR cells, and we had Brunkow and Ramsdell's master gene, FOXP3. But were they definitely connected?
Absolutely. That connection came just 2 years later, in 2003. Sakaguchi connected the dots. He proved definitively that the FOXP3 gene governs the development of the very regulatory T-cells he had first identified back in 1995.
Ah, the missing link.
The missing link. The puzzle piece fit perfectly. FOXP3 and its protein product, Scurfin, is the master regulatory gene for the entire TR-cell lineage.
So it's the single command that dictates a T-cell's fate. It essentially tells it, you are no longer a soldier, you are now a peacekeeper.
That's exactly it. And what really stands out to me is the specificity of FOXP3. You see, scientists had identified other markers sometimes found on TR cells, things like CD25 or CTLA4.
Right.
The problem was, these markers were often also expressed on regular T cells when they just got activated. It caused a lot of confusion in the field.
So you couldn't be sure if a cell expressing CD25 was truly a regulatory cell or just an activated fighter cell.
Exactly. But FOXP3 was different. It is highly and predominantly expressed in TR cells. In fact, its messenger RNA is about 100 times more abundant in regulatory T cells than in non-regulatory T cells.
100 times. That's a huge difference.
Massive. And crucially, its expression is stable in TR cells. Activating a normal, non-regulatory T cell does not simply turn FOXP3 on.
Okay, so it's not just a temporary flag. It's like the cell's permanent job description.
Precisely. This stability makes it the true molecular signature of the security guard lineage. It's the definitive marker.
The functional evidence that followed must have been pretty stunning then. We know if a mouse lacks FOXP3, if it's scurfin deficient, like the scurfy mouse, it gets fatal autoimmunity.
Right.
But the opposite experiment, that sounds even more revolutionary.
It really was. They took otherwise normal, non-regulatory, naive T cells, the T cells that would normally be ready to fight an infection, and using retroviral gene transfer techniques, they forced them to express FOXP3.
So they basically gave these normal T cells the FOXP3 instruction manual.
Exactly. And these cells weren't just changed on paper. They were reprogrammed. They became functional regulatory T cells.
Wow. So they gained the ability to suppress other T cells just by adding this one gene.
Just by adding FOXP3, they gained suppressive function. And this reprogramming power wasn't limited to just one type of helper T-cell either. They even showed that forced expression in CD8 plus T-cells, the killer T-cells, could confer suppressive activity.
That is incredible. It really demonstrates that FOXP3 is this powerful, lineage-determining master switch.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about the mechanism for a moment. How does this master switch actually turn the fighting off? How does Scurfin work?
Well, Scurfin acts as a transcription factor. That means it binds to DNA and controls the expression of other genes. It seems to function mostly as a repressor of transcription.
A repressor, so it shuts other genes down.
Generally, yes. Think of it as a molecular rheostat, or dimmer switch, for T-cell activation. When the rheostat is turned up, when Scurfin is present, and active T-cell proliferation and activation are kept in check, dampened down.
And when Scurfin is missing or broken, like in Scurfy mice or IPEX patients?
The dimmer switch is broken, stuck on full brightness. T-cells proliferate uncontrollably.
And their work also helped clarify how TR cells actually perform this suppression in the body, didn't it? It wasn't just about releasing calming chemicals.
No, that was an important finding too. In this core pathway driven by FOXP3, the suppression seems highly dependent on cell-to-cell contact.
Physical contact.
Yes. The regulatory T-cell has to physically interact with the self-reactive T-cell it's trying to shut down. Huh. It's not simply a matter of flooding the environment with general suppressive factors like TGF-beta or IL-10, though those can play roles in other contexts. This suggests a very direct, targeted mechanism of control.
Fascinating. Okay, here is where the therapeutic potential really comes into sharp focus. Looking forward to how this discovery will change medicine. Let's talk about that stunning rescue experiment involving CTLA-4.
Ah, yes. This is a remarkable finding. We already knew that mice deficient in another essential immune regulator, a protein called CTLA-4, also suffer from fatal lymphoproliferative disorders.
Right, another way to get severe autoimmunity.
Exactly. And these CTLA-4 deficient mice typically die very quickly, within just 3 to 4 weeks. Very severe, very fast.
So two different genetic defects, FOXP3 deficiency and CTLA-4 deficiency, both leading to fatal early onset autoimmunity. But what happened when the scientists took those CTLA-4 deficient mice, the ones doomed to die in weeks, and introduced the FOXP3 gene into their T-cells?
The result was striking. The disease pathology was markedly delayed. These mice, instead of dying at 3 to 4 weeks, survived for up to 180 days. The mean survival time jumped to about 150 days.
Wait, from less than a month to potentially 6 months. That's like a fivefold increase in lifespan.
Or more. Just by forcing the expression of this one gene, FOXP3,
that's incredible proof of concept, isn't it?
It really is. It demonstrated that FOXP3 expression can partially compensate even for the loss of another essential immune regulator like CTLA-4. It solidified FOXP3 as the core driver of TR cell generation and activity, likely acting upstream or parallel to some of these other crucial control mechanisms.
And the ultimate goal, of course, is translating this reprogramming ability into human therapies. Did they show it could work against actual diseases?
Yes. They show that simply forcing FOXP3 expression in naive T-cells, using that gene transfer technology, rendered them capable of preventing serious inflammatory diseases in relevant mouse models. Specifically, they showed prevention of inflammatory bowel disease, IBD, and autoimmune gastritis.
So you take normal T-cells, give them FOXP3, put them back in, and they can stop autoimmune gut disease.
That's the principle, yes.
Yeah.
And this fundamental molecular understanding of tolerance stemming from these discoveries has launched entire new clinical directions. Well, we are now seeing clinical trials focused on modulating regulatory T cells in two completely opposite directions.
Okay.
On the one hand, for cancer treatment, the goal is often to inhibit TR cells to basically release the brakes on the immune system so it can attack the tumor more aggressively.
Makes sense. Remove the security guards protecting the tumor.
Exactly. But on the other hand, for treating devastating human autoimmune diseases or preventing transplant rejection, the goal is the opposite. You want to boost TR cells or maybe generate new ones through gene therapy using FOXP3 to strengthen those brakes and restore self-tolerance.
So dialing the immune system up or down by targeting these specific cells?
Precisely. That is the immense power unlocked by their work. Sakaguchi's discovery of the regulatory T-cell, Brunko and Ramsdale's identification of FOXP3 as the gene, and that subsequent synthesis showing FOXP3 as the master switch. It has fundamentally rewritten our understanding of self-tolerance.
Yeah, it's a complete shift.
It's the realization that the body doesn't just tolerate itself passively. It actively polices itself using a highly specific, genetically determined set of instructions embodied in FOXP3 and the TR cells it creates.
And the sheer therapeutic potential here is just immense. The fact that simply transferring the FOXP3 gene into a non-regulatory T cell can essentially reprogram it into a security guard and delay or even prevent fatal autoimmunity is astonishing.
It really is. It suggests we might not just manage these diseases with lifelong treatments, but potentially cure them at the genetic or cellular level.
So we leave you with this thought. Given that we have found the master switch, FOXP3, capable of converting aggressive T cells into protective T cells, what does this raise about the future of medicine?
Yeah, think about it. Could we use gene transfer not just to fix defective genes, but to fundamentally rewire T cell lineage commitment on demand, to solve autoimmune diseases by essentially creating personalized peacekeeper armies within the patient?
Are we on the cusp of an era where autoimmune disease is no longer an incurable chronic condition, but something we can actively reverse?
That's the truly exciting question these discoveries have opened up. And it's the question we'll definitely be following in the coming years.
Thank you for joining us for this deep dive into the immune system's most important security detail.
And if you found this groundbreaking science as compelling as we do, please be sure to subscribe and share this deep dive with others who might be interested.
We'll see you next time on What the Study Says.